Hi, welcome to Thorlabs. My name is Sean, and today I'll be demonstrating how to design and build an imaging and tracking solar telescope. To demonstrate this, I'll be using lens tubes, a monochrome camera, an achromatic doublet imaging lens, neutral density filters, lens tube clamps, a small breadboard, motorized rotation stages, and an adapter bracket. Telescopes are common devices used to image distant objects during the day or the sky at night. However, an unmodified telescope should never be used to directly image the sun. It can be extremely dangerous. All the incident light in a solar telescope is focused to a small region that can either cause damage to a camera sensor or cause permanent injury. Solar telescopes use numerous filters to reduce the amount of light to a safe viewing level. As a result, you should only use a telescope to view the sun if it's been explicitly designed to do so and it meets all safety requirements. With that being said, let's look into the design requirements for an imaging and tracking solar telescope. Since we're designing an imaging solar telescope, we'll need a camera sensor. In order to form an image of the sun onto the camera sensor, we'll also need a lens. We can use lens tubes to connect the two together, but lens tubes are rarely the right length required for producing an in-focus image on the sensor. As a result, we'll need a component that allows changing the lens-to-camera distance to adjust the focus of the image. Lastly, and arguably most important, we'll need attenuation filters to reduce the intensity of the light entering the telescope and to safely image onto our camera sensor. Now that we have our general requirements for the imaging side, how do we select the right pieces of hardware for our setup? The camera we're using is a monochrome CMOS sensor with a 1 over 2.9 inch sensor type. With that known, we'll have to choose an appropriate lens. Since we're imaging the whole visible spectrum, we'll select an achromatic doublet to minimize the wavelength-dependent focal shift. For choosing the focal length, there's going to be an upper limit, since too long a focal length will produce an image that is too large for our camera sensor. To decide, we'll use the thin lens equation and the magnification equation, which relate focal length, object and image distance, as well as object and image height. Our camera sensor is wider than it is tall, so the sensor height will be the limiting dimension for our image. Let's target 80% of the sensor height to allow some margin for keeping the telescope aligned to the sun before adjustment is necessary. With this configuration, the image will be inverted, so the image height gains a negative sign on its value. We also don't know the exact image distance from the lens, so we can rearrange the magnification equation and then solve for the focal length. If we plug in the diameter and distance of the sun for the object size and object distance, we find a maximum focal length of 321 millimeters. We don't want to go over this value, so we'll use the closest off-the-shelf achromat, which has a 300 millimeter focal length. In a light-starved application, a larger diameter lens may be suggested. However, since we'll be attenuating the light, we'll use a 1-inch diameter to keep it compact. The choice of lens dictates the spacing required between the lens and camera sensor, letting us select a combination of lens tubes to provide the correct separation. To account for adjustment of the lens to sensor distance, a 1.5-inch long adjustable lens tube is used to allow a relatively large range for focus. Lastly, for the choice of neutral density filters, this can change significantly with the design of the setup. Using too low of an optical density can result in damage to the camera sensor. As a best practice, using an optical density exceeding what's anticipated should be placed on the telescope. The optical density can be reduced until an adequate exposure time is achieved. Starting with an optical density of 8, I found I was not saturating my camera, but needed longer exposure times to see an image. I removed filters until I achieved an exposure time of 10 milliseconds or less. This occurred when I used an optical density of 6 with my camera. Now that we've determined the hardware required for our solar telescope, we can start assembly. This will come together pretty fast, which emphasizes how much engineering is actually done in the design phase. So to start, I'll be using 2 4-inch lens tubes. A 2-inch lens tube. A 1.5-inch long adjustable lens tube, and this will allow us to adjust the relative camera to sensor distance. For convenience, I'll mount the lens tube assembly in this lens tube clamp and hold it in position. With that in place, now we'll add the camera. Now, when I'm adding the camera, I'm tilting the whole assembly down. This is intentional. When you're threading on two anodized components that can cause particulates to be generated that we want to avoid getting on our sensor, like pointing the whole assembly down, it mitigates that risk. So with that in place, let me tighten this down. And I'll add our camera lens. In its current state, this is our imaging telescope. While we haven't added filters yet, it'll be easier to do a rough alignment to get it in a closer position for imaging onto the sun later. To do a rough alignment, I'm going to aim the telescope at a distant object, ideally 10 plus meters away. And this will get it in a relatively close range for us to more easily adjust the focus to the sun later. Now I'll connect the camera to the computer. I'm gonna loosen the lock ring. That will allow me to adjust the focus. If I see that the image is getting blurrier, I'll switch directions. And I'll adjust until I get an in-focus image. And that looks good to me, and I'll lock the lock ring. Now that we've rough aligned the imaging focus of our telescope, we can add the attenuation filters. As mentioned previously, I ended up finding an OD of 6 was sufficient for my camera. I'm using a stack of 3 filters, and I'm using an absorptive ND filter. Using reflective ND filters would add a multiple reflecting surfaces that can cause degradation in the image quality. When I've mounted these, I've intentionally ordered them in ascending order from the lowest to the highest optical density. By doing this, I'm avoiding how much thermal stress a single filter could encounter. By the highest optical density first, most of the power is getting absorbed by that single filter. In a high energy system application, there's the probability that filter could fail, and there's not sufficient optical density remaining to prevent damage to your camera. In this case, we're simply using these with unfocused sunlight, so while I don't expect there to be thermal stress that could cause failure, it is something to consider for other setups. With our filters added, we have our imaging solar telescope. While we could keep this on our breadboard and manually follow the sun across the sky, this would require considerable effort. The sun will move off the sensor within about a minute. As a result, we can improve our system by using 2 rotation stages. Using these, we can implement something called a celestial coordinate system. This may also be called a horizontal coordinate system, elevation azimuth system, or altitude azimuth system. In this, we have our azimuth axis, which is swiveling from side to side, and our elevation or altitude axis, which is swiveling up and down. For our azimuth, 0 degrees would align with north, and for elevation, 0 degrees aligns with the horizon. Now let's remove our assembly from the post and motorize it. I'll mount the azimuth axis relatively centered on the breadboard. Next, I'll mount the 3D printed adapter bracket. Once that's in place, I can mount the elevation axis stage. Now I'm going to be adding our post holders to hold the telescope using a set screw. And I'm placing these in the two holes that are parallel with the optical table. For the second one, I'll have to remove the thumb screw to have clearance. I'll add back the thumb screw. Next, I'll need to add the second lens tube clamp. I need to adjust the relative distance so they can be received by the post holders. And I want to make sure that the telescope is going to have the lens pointing this way, so that way a positive angle in the elevation will tilt upwards. And now I'll loosen these. So that way I can make sure that there's clearance for high elevation angles if this were to tilt under the stage. With our motors added, we now have our motorized imaging solar telescope. Now we can open the software to make sure that the motors are working correctly. First, I'm going to verify that each motor is going to be moving in the correct direction. I can see moving the azimuth in a positive direction rotates it clockwise as expected. And I can see moving the elevation axis in the positive direction correctly moves it upwards. I'm going to home both stages. Next, I want to disable the backlash correction in both axes. And I'm going to persist settings to device so that way it's retained on the K-cubes. Since we now have computer control of the motors, we can implement a script that would allow automated tracking of the sun. I've implemented two Python scripts that were written in Python 3.10 that allow the automated tracking of the sun. These use the Thorlabs serial communication protocol that avoids the need for the .NET drivers. As a result, they can be used on Linux operating systems, such as the Raspberry Pi. The script takes whether the user wants to track the sun or the moon, the user's longitude and latitude of their position, their time zone, and the serial numbers for each axis controller. Before moving outside to finalize the final focus to the sun and start tracking, I need to make sure the devices will be found. I'll open Device Manager to make sure these devices show up as serial COM ports. I'll right-click, select Properties on each, go to the Advanced tab, and make sure Load VCP box is checked, which will create virtual COM ports for each axis. With those set, I'll power cycle the controllers. And now we see they have ports, and we can proceed with running our scripts. I'll first run our GUI script, which allows changing the alignment offsets and to stop the tracking. Next, I'll run the tracking script. The stages start off by homing before they eventually move to the current position of the sun and will be prompted for the user to determine whether they want to start tracking. I'll hit enter and it starts to track. We can see this works, so now we can head outside. We've replicated the same steps in the software, except this time we've aligned the breadboard so the telescope, when homed, will point north. However, we see that the sun, while in position, doesn't have the sun on camera. We can adjust the offset positions to align the telescope, but we don't know what direction to move it. This is solved using the telescope shadow. When aligned to the sun, the telescope's lens tube should cast no shadow. We can use the shadow's position to know which direction to move and adjust position and steps until the sun is on screen. I'll toggle the auto exposure in ThorCam to avoid saturation, and there we go. Now that we're tracking the sun on target, I'll loosen the lock ring and adjust the focus to the sun. Using the visible sunspots, I'll adjust the focus to the highest contrast. And that looks good to me. Today we went over the design considerations, the hardware selection, and the assembly of an imaging and tracking solar telescope. This included choosing an appropriate focal length for your camera sensor, the importance of implementing neutral density filters in a solar telescope, and how to implement motorized rotation stages for a celestial coordinate system. I hope this helps you in the lab someday. If you have any questions, please contact tech support.